Joining us now is News Corp columnist Angela Mollard and media writer for The Australian, Sophie Ellsworth. Ladies, lovely to have you back. Angela, every year the royal family releases a photo for their official Christmas card. What do they have for us this year?
Well, yes, we've got two very different photos this year. First up, obviously, the Wales family, the Prince and Princess of Wales and their three children. We've got a black and white photograph from them this year, and they've not done that before. It's always been colourful little pictures in the trees. I love this picture. I think it's super interesting. It's got a strong message in it, which is we're a very cohesive family. But I think the main point from this photograph that I've taken away is how grown up the children have become. If you, Prince George is wearing suede loafers like his father. The children are all wearing white shirts. Prince George is wearing a Ralph Lauren white shirt, which his late grandmother, Princess Diana, was a huge fan of the designer. So I think this photo is very interesting in showcasing that the kids are getting bigger. They will become part of the royal family. The King and Queen, of course, released a picture that was quite different to this. It was very traditional. It was from their coronation and was very old school in comparison. There it is, you know, lovely embossed card and them in their regal gear.
And Sophie, look, I'm not surprised that the King and the Queen obviously had a very formal type card for this year, but I think the Wales's photo, I think it strikes that that point really well, that relatability point that they've been trying to get across, don't you think?
Oh, absolutely, Caroline. Look, I love the fact that they're in more casual clothing, you know, they're not sitting there in suits and tie. You know, they're looking more relaxed, even though they are in designer Ralph Lauren. Now, that's not a cheap line of clothing to say for sure. But I think this is a lovely portrait of them. I don't know if I'm sure about the black and white element. I always like a bit of colour in photographs. But, look, I think this is a lovely portrait of the family. And as Angela said, you know, that the children really are growing up. So I think a lot of people will love seeing this picture ahead of Christmas. And it just shows that they're going for that more relaxed, down-to-earth look this year.
Yeah, absolutely. Now, Angela, we've seen some great photos this week from a Christmas carol service hosted by Princess Kate at Westminster Abbey. Can you run us through it? It just looks stunning.
It did look stunning, didn't it? It was on Friday night at Westminster Abbey. It was a Christmas carol concert, which she has led before. Her three children were there, even Prince Louis, who is, of course, only five. Kate was very much supported by other members of the royal family. The Duchess of Edinburgh was there, Beatrice, Eugenie. In fact, it was a lovely picture of Princess Beatrice because she was holding the hand of her stepson. You know, there's not a lot of stepchildren in the royal family, but her husband's son from a previous relationship, she was holding his hand. There were the kids there. There were a gorgeous little red post box for the children to put letters into for Father Christmas. But what was really striking about this event, it was very much led by Kate. She was wearing head-to-toe white. And after the week that she had, it very much signalled that the way that the royals come out of troublesome and difficult weeks is by putting their heads down and doing what's important to them. The whole sort of focus of this event was charities, it was midwives, it was people in the healthcare sector. It was about early childhood and the focus of a Christmas carol service on early childhood education. So very much in Kate's lane, very much her legacy project and a smart way to end what must have been a difficult week for her.
Yeah, absolutely. That's a great observation, actually, Angela. And Sophie, I think, again, the balance of the informality and the modernisation with the tradition around Christmas celebrations, I feel like the Prince and Princess of Wales are really striking this balance well.
Oh, they absolutely are. And when I'm looking at that vision, I'm just wishing I was there in London. I love the fact that it looks so cold over there and they're all rugged up, you know, just a few weeks out from Christmas. But as Angela said, it has been a rocky road this week with the release of Endgame, you know, earlier in the piece, and so much controversy around that book. But you wouldn't know that there was a worry in the world for Catherine and William looking at the vision here. And I think it just really shows how they're doing their utmost to really look beyond the dramas of the book and focusing on what is such a happy time of the year. And, you know, we should now be embracing that Christmas is ahead, and they're really trying to push for those good causes, as Catherine is doing for women and children and midwifery. So I think this was a wonderful display from them and a very promising event.
And Sophie, on Endgame, I'll just stay with you for a sec. There's been a huge amount of media coverage around its release. What does the aftermath look like for all the main protagonists?
Well, Caroline, I just finished reading that book. What a disaster it was. I mean, it was just a hate fest on the royal family. What would you expect? Nothing more from Omid Scobie. I mean, that's his modus operandi, is to attack, attack and attack and defend Meghan and Harry. So, look, I think these things do wash over. I think people even question the authenticity of him. I mean, he's been caught lying himself. I mean, he was caught out saying he was a certain age to the Times of London, and it turned out he gave the wrong age. I don't know how you could confuse your actual age. So, look, I think people take his content with a grain of salt, but this will wash over the royals. It might take a few months to do so, but they've been through all this before with Spare, with Netflix and so forth. They'll rise above it.
And Angela, you've been reporting on the royal family for, I'm pretty sure, decades. How does the impact of this book compare to royal exposés of the past?
Yeah, I'm that old, Caroline. Yeah, look, Sophie's right. It is going to wash over. And interestingly, I did a bit of a deep dive on the sales of this book. So far, in the first 5 days of publication in the UK, it had only sold 6,500 copies. That's compared to 31,000 copies for Finding Freedom, which was Omid Scobie's earlier book. Now, if you compare that with Harry's book, Spare, in its first week, it sold close to 450,000 copies. So the impact of Spare was far greater in terms of readership, in terms of the crisis that it could have caused within the royal family. But as to Sophie's point, what happens when the royals are confronted with these issues, and really Omid Scobie isn't a threat to them, is that they focus on the work that they do, and they have the cameras on them when they're doing that charity work, when they are doing what the Crown does. And very smartly, by focusing on that, it will wash over. Look, in comparison to Diana, who her true story in 1992, I was living in the UK reporting on that at the time. That was a shocking book because there were a lot of admissions from the Princess of Wales. But of course, we didn't know at that time that she was the source of the book. Dimbleby's book on Prince Charles, when he admitted that he had been unfaithful to Diana, was of course huge. The book, Anna Pasternak's book on James Hewitt and Diana's love story, all shocking. But what always endures is this family.
Yeah, absolutely. And now, look, Omid Scobie still denies any wrongdoing when it comes to the Dutch version of his book Endgame, revealing the names of King Charles and Princess Catherine. Here it is.
We saw that there was one name in the book, and so the Dutch publisher told us there was a translation error. And so you get on with the day, and then it sort of unfolds from there. So I'm looking forward to finding out more about it, because the English version of the book, the only one I know, the version that I signed off on, that is the book that is out there today. That's the book that has no names in it. And I make it very clear, because ultimately, to write the names, it's a show and tell situation.
But Angela, the Dutch publishers seem to disagree. I've got about a minute left. What's the latest?
Yeah, very quickly. What happened is the Dutch publishers have come out and said, no, we were working on a manuscript that had the names in it. And it's since occurred that Omid's publisher in the UK had sent an early version which had the names in it. Omid, of course, had said he'd never submitted a copy that had the names in it. He had submitted an earlier copy, as has since transpired. That copy was set. This was a pre-legal copy. So in the early days, that copy was due to be updated for the transcribers, and then of course that hasn't happened, and so it's come out with those names in it. So, like, not a good look for Omid Scobie, because his credibility is under question there. Equally, not such a good look for his agent. But good on the Dutch publishers for standing up for themselves.
Yeah, not a good look for anyone, frankly. Angela Mollard, Sophie Ellsworth, thank you so much for joining us.